Hello, sir.
How are you?
I'm good, thanks be to God, and you?
Very good, very good.
Good, what's your name?
Yahya.
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 Nice to meet you, Yahya.
Nice to meet you. How are you doing?
I'm all right, thank you. Tell me, what are your thoughts on Christianity?
My thought on Christianity, to be honest...
We need to talk.
My thought on Christianity, to be honest, you've been disobeying Jesus' teaching and following Paul's teaching. This is my opinion. As I say that Jesus, peace upon him, teach as previous prophet and messenger teach, the Lord our God is one.
Yep.
And you manage somehow to break this God into three deities, person, element, whatever. And instead of worshiping the true God, which been addressed by Jesus and John 10:7, the true God is the Father who sent him. You are worshiping the second element, where he as well teach that the Father is greater than the Son and greater than all. That means he include himself in the creation.
Can I reply to this?
May I just add one more?
Yes, of course.
God is greater than all the creation, including Jesus. And there's no equality between the Creator and the creation. And this is the difference which where I say Christianity went in the wrong way.
Okay. So, sorry. Let's just deal with that, because you mentioned a number of points. Firstly, the brother says that we're following the teachings of Paul, not the teachings of Jesus. I would like to see how that is true. So, when you speak next, maybe you can bring forward your evidence.
No problem.
Because what actually happens is that Jesus preaches the coming of the kingdom of God. And he understands the coming of the kingdom of God as being in his person. I.e., he himself, his presence on earth, his activity on earth, is the kingdom of God coming. And you see that in Mark. You see that in Matthew. You see that in Luke. You see that in John. And then Paul teaches that Jesus Christ is our Savior. So Jesus teaches that the kingdom of God has come, and that the kingdom of God has come because he is here, and then Paul teaches that Christ is our Savior. So I fail to see how these two teachings are in contradiction, because the gospel of Christ is the coming of the kingdom of God in himself. The gospel of Paul is that Jesus Christ is the Savior, and that people enter the kingdom through Jesus. So those two gospels are the same. Now, you also said that Jesus said that the Father has sent him. Now, this doesn't contradict anything that Christians believe, because we believe that the Father sent the Son. So pointing that out is not a problem. And then you said that Jesus said that the Father is greater than I. And we believe, as you see in the Common Christi in Philippians chapter 2, that Christ, who being equal with God, does not grasp at equality, but humbles himself, like a servant becoming a man, even a man on a cross. So Christ becomes a man, humbling himself like a servant, and then says that the Father is greater than I. This does not contradict what I believe. There is no argument there. But now that I've addressed the verses that you've mentioned, you mentioned that Jesus said that, remember, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one, which is the statement that is the foundational statement of Judaism. But what perhaps you don't know, Yahya, what you don't know, Yahya, is that in that verse that you're quoting, the Hebrew word that is translated into English is ekad. Ekad is a plural compound singular. An example of that is where it says in Genesis that a man shall leave his house and shall become one, ekad, with his wife. So the two become one. So God says, remember, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is ekad, a plural compound. So what makes up this plural compound? The Father, who is God. Jesus, who is God, and the Holy Spirit, who is God. And why do I say that? I'll say it because you said that Jesus never claimed equality with the Father. I'm going to show you why you're wrong. Read it with me and then let's just talk about it.
You read it, I listen. Yeah.
Jesus says, this is Jesus speaking now. For not even the Father judges anyone, but he has given all judgment to the Son. So notice the Trinitarian language, Father and Son. The Father has given judgment to the Son. So that all will honor the Son even as they honor the Father. So he's saying the honor that you give to God, give to me as the Son. So Jesus is claiming for himself divine worship that is due only to the Father. So will you take Jesus seriously like you did with all the other verses? And will you now honor the Son as you honor the Father?
Okay. You're done?
Yeah, I want you to deal with this verse, though.
I will deal with whatever I like.
So he's not going to deal with my verse. Go on.
I let you say whatever
yes,
you said.
Yes, of course. Go on.
I'm going to go back a little bit back. First, let's define who is God and why God sends the Son. God, the Bible and many verses teach that God doesn't change his nature. God is immortal, invisible, and has no beginning, and he's immortal. While Jesus, his nature is mortality, he has a beginning, he has an end, and he's visible to everybody. Besides, if you look back, why God the Father sends the Son, you will see that the Father is sending the Son according to you. So he died to save the believer or the sinner. And by doing that, that makes God the Father unjust to the Son, because the Son is innocent, and just to himself by incarnating in his own creation to die while he's immortal, he will become mortal. While he's invisible, become visible. While he's eternal, he become limited in space and time, which contradict the teaching of the Lord is one. And when you say Ahad, it means one, not as many, one. And I will allow you to reflect on when Jesus, peace upon him, teach and pray to the believer to become one in him with the Father. Have the believer become one and the Father, and they become God, or they become one and the believing of the oneness of God, and the believing of the oneness of God. Because when Jesus was among his apostle, was among his people, first he was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel, and he preached for 3 years to the lost sheep of Israel. He commanded his disciple not to go among the Samaritan and Gentiles, and just go rather to the people of Israel. So, but I find the contradiction after the resurrection, which I don't believe that the resurrection happened, that he's saying, go and baptize in the name of the Father, which contradict the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, which contradicts the greatest commandment. He himself teach our Lord is one Lord.
Can I reply?
Yeah, please.
Okay, so please notice that when Yahya gave his verses, I dealt with every single verse that he gave. So I'll ask him again. So we'll read it again. Because Yahya says that Jesus never claimed equality with God the Father. So we'll read it again. For not even the Father. Now, I think it's fair to say that Yahya equates the Father with Allah. So let's just put Allah into this verse. Jesus says, for not even Allah judges anyone, but Allah has given all judgment to the Son, so that all will honor the Son even as they honor Allah. No, 1 second, don't interrupt. No, don't interrupt. You had your chance to deal. Don't interrupt, deal with it then. So, Christ is saying, honor me as you honor the Father. Honor to God is worship. And actually, the very word in Greek is talking about worship. And Jesus is saying, honor the Son as you honor the Father. In other words, worship the Son as you worship the Father. That, ladies and gentlemen, is Jesus saying, I am God and worship me. There we go. Now, one second. He talked about God not changing. Do you all hear him say that? God doesn't change. So, God is a father. If God is a father and does not change, who has he been the father to? The obvious answer is that he must be eternally the father. And if he is eternally the father, that means he must eternally be the father to someone. So who is that? If Jesus was created, it can't be Jesus. And if there was nothing before God created anything, it can't be creation. So if God becomes the father of creation, that means he changes. But if the Father is eternally the Father, and there is a Son who is also eternal, then that means the Father has eternally been the Father, and the Son has eternally been the Son. So when the Son enters into humanity, he doesn't stop being the Son. He actually addresses himself as the Son of the Father, and so God has not changed. It isn't about his immortality. The immortal remains immortal. The human nature is something that is created and dies. If Yahya had even bothered to pick up a book about the Christian faith and read the declarations of the Council of Ephesus, rather than coming here with the typical Dawah script that every Muslim uses, because they've never read a book, they've only read a Muslim tract about Christianity and listened to a Zaki Naik video and read a book by Ahmed Didat, he would know that the Christian church teaches that the immortal God does not die on the cross. It is only the humanity. Jesus, there's your answer. It is only the humanity. It is only the humanity of Jesus, which Christ takes upon himself, that dies on the cross. And that is actually what the Bible teaches. And I will show it to you. But I want to allow you a time to reply.
Can you please allow me to answer before you open another...
Yes, of course.
God, when he sent Jesus, peace upon him, to the lost sheep of Israel and give him the authority and permission, and he will be witness against them because he was sent to them and they reject him. And whoever rejects the messenger of God, that means he actually rejecting God himself. And this is where you went wrong, because I talked about that God, Jesus, peace upon him, never said, I myself incarnate in the shape of the Son to come and die, because he would be split into one or two or three. And this is going against the teaching of Christ. All Israel is the Lord. Our God is one. And he teach my God and your God, my Father and your Father. Besides, when he himself fell on his face like any other prophet and messenger and worshiped the one who sent him, because he didn't come by himself, because when I come by myself, but if I was sent, that means I am a messenger, a mediator sent by somebody else. I cannot send myself, because I will come. And Jesus, he, according to John 7, 13, verse 7, he said, God, the true God, is the Father who sent me. And he never equal himself to the Father. I tell you why he never equal to himself. Because he's saying, if you believe in me and follow me, because his teaching is not his own teaching. Whatever God give him permission and send him to do, he come to do. And that's why he is not God, because only God knows about the hour. And the Son, he addressed himself that only the Father knows about the hour. The Son, they don't know, knows not about the hour, not even the angel. So his knowledge is limited comparing with the knowledge of Almighty God who created him and sent him.
Okay, so notice again that for the second time, he did not address my point. So I'll give it to him again. And maybe, because it is the trend of the Dawah team, that if you ask them the same question three times, they actually register what you're saying and they get off their script that they stick to religiously and deal with the point that you make. So I'll read it to you again. In John 5:7, you claimed, Jesus never claimed to be God or worship me. He says this, for not even the Father judges anyone, but he has given all judgment to the Son.
Stop.
No, don't interrupt. Don't interrupt, Yahya.
I want to say
in all the debates that I've seen Yahya in, he's so much more dignified than the rest of the Dawah team.
Thank you very much.
He is an example to the Dawah team of how to conduct yourself in a debate and a discussion. He is civilized. He is civilized. He has manners. He has good conduct.
Thank you very much.
And I believe that those qualities are the qualities that will lead him to Christ if he follows them. Now, Yahya. So, Christ says, for not even the Father judges anyone, but he has given all judgment to the Son. So he has said that the Father has given judgment to him. So Jesus is saying, the Father is not going to judge you, I'm going to judge you. That's only what God can do.
Okay.
Then he goes on to say, so that all will honor the Son even as they honor the Father.
Okay.
So how do you honor the Father? You honor him through worship. How therefore should you honor the Son? You honor him through worship. There you go. So I want you to deal with that, Yahya, in your turn.
Okay.
Then he quoted, but he gave the wrong reference. He said it was John 7. It's not. It was John 17.
17:3.
John 17. Now, this is what the Dawah team do all the time. They pick and choose their verses. They quote them according to a script.
Yeah.
And then they ignore the rest of the book. What they do is they pick these verses, cherry pick these verses, and then they ignore the rest of the book, right? They ignore them. But if you are going to be honest to the text, you have to deal with what all of the text says, not just the bits that suit your argument. So he quoted 17 verse 3. I'm going to read the rest that he ignores. So I'll pick up from verse 17, 3. Listen. It says, no, you're going to wait. You raised a number of points, I'm addressing them. So, 17:3, this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, that's speaking of the Father, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the work that you have given me to do. Now listen to the next bit, the bit that contradicts his argument. Now, Father, glorify me. That means to raise me up, to elevate me. Glorify me together with yourself. So the glory of the Father is now given to the Son, with the glory which I had with you before the world was. So Jesus is saying that before the world existed, before there was a universe, before there was time, before there was space, he shared the glory of the Father. Now, since he believes that the Father is equivalent to Allah, let's just read that verse again. Now, Allah, glorify me together with yourself, the glory which I had with you before the world was. Jesus is saying in black and white, I am God. Worship me, therefore. Now, he mentioned another point. Now, the problem is, Yahya doesn't deal with my points, but I take the time to deal with his. Why? Because I am not working from a script. But the Dawah team, they don't come here with scholarly education. They come here with repetition of arguments they've heard from the likes of Zaki and Ike. They've never studied these things. Said that we Christians believe that God died. That's a straw man argument. Christians have never claimed that God died on a cross. That's a lie that Hashim tells Muslims. That's a lie that Yahya believes because he watches videos of Hashim at Speaker's Corner. This is what we believe. This is what the Council of Ephesus clarified when it said the immortal does not die. Therefore, Christ has suffered in the flesh. In other words, he died in his humanity, not in his divinity. The divine does not die. Perfect. Your turn.
Thank you very much for this long.
Maybe don't raise so many points if you don't want a long reply.
It's okay. But you know, I dealt with your issue the first time. It seems that you didn't really was listening to me, because when I said Jesus was given permission from higher authority, that means he was given the authority to judge. So the Father, he's given authority to the
Amen.
Son.
We agree. Yeah. Amen.
And that means the Father needs somebody else, which is his higher authority, to give him this authority. Is that what I said? And I remind you that the Son doesn't know about the hour, only the Father. And this is, doesn't mean that he's, that mean his knowledge is limited. And that means when you say God the Father and God the Son, you split God into three gods, three baby gods, which the Father is the greater. I don't know why you're laughing, because
you'll find out when it's my turn.
You're accusing me of listening to Zach and Nayak or Didat or whoever, but I myself, for 3 years, I studied the Bible in Arabic and English and note down everything. And as I read the Quran, I tried to extract the truth from the Bible as to come to conclusion from Torah and Injil, which is the Bible and the Quran. What is the real truth? And the real truth is nobody equal to the Creator, who is the Father. And the Father is our Creator, and we are in a spiritual way, his son or children, as you claim, but we are not in a physical way. And Jesus, when he teach that we or him, that glorify me as you glorify God, he himself, when he fell down on the floor, tell me if I'm wrong, he worshiped the God, the Father, who sent him. And he didn't worship himself, because if I go down and I worship myself, there's no glorification for myself, because Jesus, he didn't teach his apostle or the people who he's being sent to, the Jew, to that worship me and forget about God. And that's why, because he's making confusion to the creation, there's two God, one up in heaven, one on earth. And you said the flesh died. If the flesh died, that means God, as we said, doesn't need to incarnate to die to save his own creation and so to satisfy them, because as long as Jesus comes to the sinner and the sinner repent and follow the teaching of Jesus, they will have eternal life because they believe in the God who sent Jesus as the Father. That means there's no need for him to die, because God is all merciful, all loving, and all forgiver. But if God wants the price, that price to forgive, that means he wants the price for his forgiveness, and that means he is not merciful. And one more point, I'm not part of any Dawah team. I come by myself. I talk to people by myself. I listen to people, I listen to you, I listen to other people. I take note down whatever you say. Lot of whatever you say sometimes right, sometimes I disagree with, and we have the right to disagree, and we have the right to come to conclusion. Everyone is different.
Can I reply?
Please do.
If only they did that in Saudi Arabia. If only they did that in Saudi Arabia, where Islam has been unchallenged for 1400 years. So there is no more better example of what an Islamic culture looks like than Saudi Arabia. And in Saudi Arabia, we could not have this conversation in the public square. So when they tell you that all moral systems are equal, it's utter rubbish. Because the reason why Yahya can stand here and have such a dignified discussion with me today is because Britain has been influenced by 1,000 years of Christianity. And the reason why we can't have this debate in the middle of Riyadh is because Saudi Arabia has been dominated by Islam for 1,400 years.
Hadouken!
No, you may not. I'm going to reply to your point. Now, he said, his second straw man nonsense. Because, once again, Yahya, it's an unusual name, it's difficult for me to pronounce.
Only Sayyid, maybe it's Sayyid.
Is that alright?
Sayyid is...
Sayyid
is much easier.
You called him the divine name earlier, that was terrible.
Sayyid.
So Sayyid created another straw man. He said that we split God into three. Now this again is taking some verses, cherry picking them, and ignoring the rest. As Christians, we believe in Old and New Testament. And the Old Testament is clear that there is only one God.
Thank you.
That is what I believe.
Thank you.
I believe that, Sayyid. Okay. You're not teaching me that.
No, I didn't.
I believe it. And the Dawah team come round the corner, they say things that Christians believe like they've proven some kind of point. We believe that, Sayyid. You're not teaching us anything.
Okay.
Nothing.
Okay.
But what you did do is you lied. You lied and said that we Christians are dividing Father and Son and Holy Spirit into three. We Christians have said at our councils, at the Council of Nicaea and the Council of Constantinople, that the nature of the Son in relation to the Father is this: God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made. In other words, the substance of the Son is the same as the substance of the Father. There is no division. It isn't a new substance. It isn't that the substance of the divine has been divided in two.
Perfect.
And the scriptures teach this. We read in Isaiah 45, "For thus says the Lord, who created the heavens, he is the God who formed the earth and made it. He established it and did not create it a waste place, but formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord, and there is none else."
Excellent.
It also says in Isaiah 45, 23, "I have sworn by myself." Now notice that the divine Yahweh swears by himself. But this fictitious God called Allah of the Quran,
yes,
swears by planets and birds. How can you swear by something that he's lesser than you. Our God swears only by himself.
Perfect.
I have sworn by myself. The word has gone forth from my mouth in righteousness and will not turn back. That to me every knee will bow and every tongue will swear allegiance. The scriptures teach that everyone will bow to Jesus and swear allegiance to him. It also says in Isaiah, listen to me, O Jacob. So God is speaking. Who is he speaking to? Listen to me, O Jacob, even Israel, whom I called, I am he. Ego I me in the Greek. I am the first, I am also the last. Muslims will recognize that title because those are the divine names of Allah. Why then does Jesus say in Revelations? Jesus says in Revelations, behold, I am coming quickly and my reward is with me to render to every man according to what he has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. So Jesus is calling himself the God of Israel. And this is Jesus speaking. I, Jesus, is speaking. So Jesus is calling himself the God of Israel, and he says he doesn't have a beginning and he doesn't have an end. Tell me, Yahya, tell me, Saeed, why is Allah stealing the divine titles of Jesus? You have said we believe in three gods. Show me where it's taught in this book or retract the statement. Your turn.
Allah, if you open any Arabic Bible, you will read in Genesis 1:31, you will read the word Allah 31 times. For the Hebrew, Allah is the God of the Jew. And you will find it in the Deuteronomy. I'm not able to give the exact reference, but it in Hebrew, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is the God, the eternal God to the Jew and to the Muslim. And all the Arabic country, the Christian, they believe that God, his name is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not Yahweh. And Yahweh is equal to Baal and equal to Shaitan. And he's not the true God of the Christian, even of the Jew. And I can show you, Yahweh derived from, as I said, Baal. And there is, Baal is an idol being worshipped. And as Abraham and Moses and Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, all of them, they demolish all the idols and ask people to worship the invisible, eternal, immortal God. And
immortal.
Immortal, yeah. And no, not mortal, no. And actually, Jehovah. Now I can show you why Jehovah is not God, because in Hebrew language there's no G, so it's Yahweh. Yahweh. You can read the, I guess your English is better than my English. And in Jeremiah 23:27, Jeremiah actually, he's talking to the Jews that they have forgotten my name for Baal.
Can I reply?
Yeah, please.
Okay. So, I don't know how many times I have to read the same verse to the bro before he will actually do me the courtesy of engaging with the words. Yeah? And this is what I mean, guys. This is why, if Christians learn apologetics and polemics, we've got nothing to fear from the Muslims. Because their educational system is deficient. The educational system is simply about learning from rote and repeating what someone else says. It's not about analysis. It's not about critical thinking.
Excellent.
Now, he said that in Genesis, you'll find the term Allah there. Now, I don't care if that's true or not. For the sake of argument, I'll say it is. Christians can call God Allah. We can call God Allah. Arabic Christians did it for centuries before Islam ever arrived on the stage. So I've got no problem with the word Allah. I'll do it myself if ever I worship God in Arabic. No problem. But what is actually important is the image of Allah. Is it the same as the image of Allah that the Christians believe in? So let us compare the image of Allah in the Quran and the image of God and the image of Satan in the Bible. So let's just pull up some verses. In verse 59:23 of the Quran, one of the 99 names of Allah is Al-Mutakabbir. Sorry, I've slaughtered the Arabic. Right, 59:23. If you speak Arabic, you can correct.
Al-Mutakabbir.
Thank you. And how would you translate it?
I translate it the Most High, which have no equal between all his people and his creation.
Okay.
And this is what it means.
Thank you. Others translate it as the Most Proud.
It is the Most Proud. Also.
It is the Most Proud. Now listen to how the Bible describes Satan. Satan was cast out of heaven because of his pride, Isaiah 14:12-15, Ezekiel 23:11-19. In the Quran, Allah is described as Al-Mumit,
Al-Mumit,
which is translated by some as the destroyer. Quran, Ayah 3:156. Quran, Ayah 7:158. Quran 15:23, Surah 57 and Ayah 2. The Bible describes Satan as the destroyer. 1 Corinthians 10:10. So, we might have a word in common, but we don't have a concept in common.
Perfect.
And as Shakespeare said when he put the words into Juliet's mouth, or was it Romeo? I forget. Romeo, Romeo, where art for art now? For what is it? What is a name? If you call a rose by any other name, would it not smell as sweet? I can't remember if that was Romeo or Juliet. The point being, a name means nothing. And the Dawah team want to make it into a big deal. What really matters is what lays behind the name. And the description of Allah in the Quran matches the description of Satan in the Bible.
May I answer?
Of course you can. You didn't answer any other point I raised.
Yeah, exactly. Like I'm always talking on the left and you talk on the right. Anyway, regarding Al-Muhyi, Al-Mumit, the one who gives life is Almighty God. The one who takes lives is Almighty God. So Al-Muhyi, Al-Mumit, that means who's the one who gives life to whoever he wants. He's the one who takes life from whoever he wants. And Shaitan, he have not this authority over the creation. And Shaitan, he disobey God with his arrogance, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still allow him to live and carry on till the day of judgment. And Shaitan, he's our enemy number one. Ignorance, our enemy number two. Arrogance, our enemy number three. And this Shaitan, he disobey God, he disobey, and he promised God that he will mislead us and take us to hellfire. And whoever disobey God, and God is why he is the most proud, God is, he's the creator, and he has the right to be the most proud, because for him there's no equality because of his creation. And God wouldn't humble himself and be incarnate into flesh to be beaten and brutally humiliated and die on the cross to forgive his own creation. God can, as Ezekiel teach, when you come with a new heart and good deed and do the decree of Almighty God, God will forgive you and will grant you paradise, because you changed, you reject the evil of Shaitan and you obey the messenger of God, all the messenger and prophet, and believe in what they guide you to Almighty God. That's why we have no issue that Almighty God, he's the creator, he's the giver of life, he's the taker of life, he's the most proud, and he's the one who is only worthy of worship only. And Jesus, peace upon him, when he fell on his face, he fell on his face to please and obey and submit and serve who sent him, Almighty God. He's the mediator between God and his creation, because the creator, he don't need to come himself into his creation and be beaten and lose all his pride for his creation to be.
I'm truly sorry, Asher.
Please stay with me. God don't need to be humiliated by his creation to forgive them. And God don't, I will allow you, God don't send God, don't split to another God, and send God to die to satisfy the God himself. So God don't send God to be killed, that God will forgive, because the forgiveness doesn't need. I will give you, I never interrupt. I will allow you. God don't need a blood to forgive, because God is the most merciful and the source of all good and love. And he create us to sin, then acknowledge our sin, repent, and he will go forgive us. He doesn't say that he needs us to die so he forgive us, but to repent and be sincere with him.
Okay,
please.
So let's just deal with these points. Firstly, the Islamic religion does not have monopoly on the idea of good works. Christians are called to live a life of a generosity of heart and spirit, which is the very reason why Christians establish things like the NSPCC, the Salvation Army, the Red Cross. All of these are examples of Christians collectively working for the good. And we've just done a big talk about how Christianity teaches virtue ethics, and as Christians, we are called to practice the habit of doing good until it becomes, no, you're going to wait like I did. You're going, until we do good as part of who we are. So talking about doing good means nothing.
Okay.
Because our concepts of God are different. Our concept of God as sovereign, as holy, as pure, means that no sin at all can enter into his presence. None. Zero. So, I do not deny that people can do good things, and that in a percentage wise, to use a crass analogy, someone might live a life that is 92% good and 8% bad. Now, the fact of the matter is, our concept of God, means that 8% means that you can't enter into God's presence. Now, to use an analogy, it's like if I give you a glass of milk, but I put into it cyanide. That's the proportion of cyanide needed to kill you is far less than the milk overall. You wouldn't drink the milk because it's poisonous, even though most of it is good. So it is with God. So something needs to happen to extract that poison from us, to take it away. Now, human beings are born in sin and are by nature sinful. Therefore, we cannot find the solution to this problem ourselves. There is nothing that we can do to make ourselves good enough to enter into God's presence. Now, he says that the sacrifice of blood is not needed. Well, I end up scratching my head, because Muslims believe that Moses was a prophet of Allah, and Moses taught the sacrificial system, the shedding of blood for the forgiveness of sins. So what happened? Did Allah change his mind between Moses and Muhammad? Did he send Moses to reveal a temple system of temple sacrifice, the shedding of blood for the forgiveness of sins, and then when Muhammad came along, went, hold on a minute, I don't need that, I can just forgive people? Oh no, there's a contradiction in the Islamic narrative, and I'll tell you why there's a contradiction. Because Muhammad claimed prophets as Muslims without any knowledge of what they taught. And if you read the Torah, you will see that Moses taught a sacrificial system. But why did the Jews continually have to have sacrifices year after year on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement? And if you don't believe me, go and speak to the Jews what they taught. It was because those sacrifices were never sufficient. Jeez, they were pointing to a sufficient answer. The answer of the Messiah that the Jews wait expectantly for. And when he comes, he himself will fulfill the law and thus do away with the sacrificial system. How can he do away with the sacrificial system? By becoming the Lamb of God. And thus, it takes God to become man and to take that role as the sacrificial lamb to deal with the consequences of sin. He quotes prophets that he doesn't understand. He quotes books that he doesn't know. He doesn't deal with the verses that I ask him to deal with, like John 5:7, where Jesus says, honor me as you honor the Father. He doesn't deal with it. So this is going to be the last round and I'm going to end the conversation. And I ask you to deal with the verse where Jesus says, honor me as you honor the Father. In other words, honor me as you honor Allah. What honor do you owe to Allah that you don't owe to Jesus? And any honor that you give to Allah, do you not make also that honor given to Jesus, showing that Jesus is God? Deal with that point, and then I'm going to stop.
I would like, before I say anything, I would like you just to answer my question. When Jesus fell on his face to worship his Father and his God, was he worshiping himself at the same time? Yes or no? And explain, please.
Okay, so I asked him to deal with the point that he's avoided four times in this debate. Four times I've asked him to deal with this question, and every single time he ignores it. And I'll tell you why. Because he's working from a script. And if you ask him to talk about something that's not on the script, he hasn't got a clue what to say. So he just repeats the script, and he hasn't got any critical thinking. So, notice the hecklers. Notice the hecklers. Guys, I'm going to stop. You're just being rude. I'm talking to him, not to you.
I beg you, brother.
Yeah, don't be rude. Here we go again.
I beg you, brother.
How many times have we seen this at the corner?
Please.
How many times has it been caught on camera that you tried to have a calm conversation and then the Muslim Dawah team come along and interrupt everything.
Please. I don't know what a conversation
is about.
Answer
the question, please.
So, I will answer the question and then I'm going to go.
Go ahead.
Right. Who was Jesus worshipping?
There you go.
Who was Jesus worshipping? He was worshipping the Father. That's fine. He became man so that a faithful Israel would meet a holy God. And in his humanity, he worships the Father. He speaks to the Father. But he was doing that before he became incarnate.
It's enough. It's
the
enough.
Father was speaking to the Son.
It's enough.
No.
Answer,
yeah, yeah.
Answer.
No, yeah, yeah.
No,
I'm going
you,
now.
You answer.
I'm going now. I've asked you four times to answer
I
my question.
Answer you, but
too late. You had four attempts.
What's
you ignored
late?
Everyone.
What's too late?
Too late.
Yeah, brother, please.
This guy's a waste of time.
I'm sorry?
Can I just say one thing?
Yeah, of course you can.
I wasn't here at the beginning. I don't want the debate.
Yeah, you
don't.
Yeah, fair enough.
This guy's been very balanced.
Yes.
You've been quite critical against his religion.
That's correct.
And against him, to be honest.
Yes.
And quite ill-mannered.
Well, not let him speak. You're allowed to do your interpretation, sir.
You are. But I think everybody around here has listened to you.
And
you've just put this guy down.
So?
It doesn't matter.
I challenge his religion. Do you feel that I've challenged? No, have I insulted you?
Wait,
have I insulted you?
No, he did that assault
me. Did you hear that?
Just one second.
Wait, one second.
Just one second.
You just said I put him down. He has just corrected you. Now retract what you said.
Just one second.
I didn't say you put him down.
Yeah, you did.
But I think everybody around here has listened to you.
And
you've just put this guy down.
That is on camera. Anyway.
Just one second. Just one second.
Yeah, yeah, I'm going.
Hold on.
No. Yeah, yeah. You had five attempts to answer my question, you never did.
I want to say
so
something.
Go.
I want to close.
Are you
going to
answer my question?
I will answer your question.
Good question. I'll repeat the question.
Stop.
Let me repeat the question.
Just allow me to say something.
Yes, let me repeat the question that you said you're going to answer.
Yeah.
Jesus said, honor me as you honor the Father.
That's the question.
Answer the question.
The Father, actually, he didn't honor the Son. He sent him to be slaughtered for the sin of other people. God humiliates Jesus, and God the Father, according to him, is a criminal and just Father. Because when the Son prayed to the Father, take away this cup of me, the Father turned blind eye to the Son, the man, and Jesus teach, seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be open. Ask, and you will.
Did anyone hear an answer to my question?
Hold on.
JC, let's go.
Where?
Yeah, yeah. It's a pleasure talking to you.
Let's go. You don't allow me to say one sentence.
No, you talk. I've asked you five times to answer one question. You've ignored it every time.
Yeah, yeah.
It's been a pleasure.
Wait.
No, I'm going.
It's off the topic.
I'm going, yeah.
Okay.
I'm going.
Just one verse.
Don't make me be rude. I am leaving.
You are rude. Be rude, but allow me this verse.
I'm leaving. I want to
I never mention Islam. I never mention Islam. During this talk, I never mention Islam. I talk about Christianity and what you teach. And your teaching is degrading to God himself.
Thank you, Yakya.
Because you make God.
Thank you, Yakya.
Anyway, they're
going to
cut this bit.
It doesn't matter.
Let's give it a little chance.
So let's just do a wrap-up. Yaya, we see, like many of the Dawah team today, we're going to get interrupted by a Muslim. So Yaya today, Muslim enters to be rude.
So why
I'm doing a talk, yeah, and then I'm going. If you want to talk to me,
why are you running away from?
No one's running away from you, bro. So. You're not ugly enough. You're too handsome. So anyway, so let's just.
That's a bit fruity,
yeah,
mate.
Yeah, it's a bit fruity. There we go. Like, so, no one's running away from you. You're not scary.
I'm not running away.
Yeah, there you go. Thank you. Anyway,
don't edit that.
Yaya,
a bit of comedy in it.
Yeah, it's gonna be there.
You need
don't
a bit of comedy in it.
You know what I mean? So Yaya was given five opportunities.
Yeah, John.
Saeed was given five opportunities to answer a single question. And the thing is, and this is what we find again and again with all the Muslim speakers, the Dawah team.
Come on.
They have this script, and the moment you take them off the script, they're clueless. They haven't got anything to say. Because they've got a script that they've learned and they just stick to the script.
If you invite them
to do critical thinking, to engage with the evidence, to actually think as an intelligent person, they're clueless. They got nothing.
Okay, but for
so the question I propose to every Muslim who's watching this Jesus said, honor me as you honor the Father.
Jesus said, worship your Father, yeah? Who is one.
That's what he said. And then he said, honor me as you honor the Father.
The Trinity was invented in the Council of Nicaea 100 years later.
Text. Now notice the heckler.
I'm speaking truth.
Yeah, the man who's
your version of truth,
innit? Notice the man
Everyone's
who's interrupting.
Speaking their own version of truth.
So, guys, the fact is, as you can see, they have no arguments. They create strawmen saying that we say God died on the cross. We don't. We say that humanity died on the cross.
Is Jesus white or black?
They say that God changed.
We
say that God does not change. They say that we believe in three gods. We say we believe in one God. They don't deal with anything we're saying, and all they do is create straw men. And that is why it's important, brothers and sisters, that you learn your faith and learn how to defend it.
The Jews, right?
Anyway, God bless.
The Jews, right?
Why did you bring color into it? Why did you bring color into it?
Hang on, are you serious?
So I said it wrong.
No. Are you serious? Are you serious?
Yeah, I'm serious.
I'll take you to Numbers 12, where it shows you how Moses was married to an Ethiopian woman.
I said it wrong. I meant African.
You don't know, bro.
Muhammad came from mankind.
He said you should follow an Arab religion.
Muhammad came from mankind.
You should worship in Arabic. You should bow down to an Arab city. You should imitate an Arab man.
No, Muhammad came from
mankind.
Dress
like an Arab man. Copy the habit of Arab culture.
Jesus clearly said, I came from worship of Israel.
Bro, you don't need that.
Why are you barging?
Why are you barging, bro?
Across the desert like an Arab man.
Why are you barging?
You're pushing.
Come on, man.
You're barging, bro. I'm just saying. And you're not barging me out of the way. Right? Don't you want to come and
just go.
Don't barge, man, bro. Don't barge.
Why are you pushing?
Follow an Arab instead is what he wants.